A house. Have you ever stopped to look at your own house and to wonder why it's built in just the way it is? It must give shelter, a roof and walls, windows to let in light. Then there must be an opening and a door to close it. But why are houses built at different times or in different parts of the country so unlike one another? One reason is because of the kind of building material used. In the past, when transport was difficult, houses were usually made from local materials. Stone from nearby quarries. Timber. Where the clay was suitable, it was baked into bricks. And so these different materials naturally made the houses look different. A thatched roof of straw or reeds is quite unlike one made with baked clay tiles. Here is a wall built of stone. This one has wooden beams. Brick gives a neat and regular checker work. Details may be different too. Here is one kind of doorway, and here another. Here is a window with a wooden frame. This one has a heavy stone lintel. And this is a modern window with a steel framework. The second reason why houses differ so much is perhaps even more important. It's because the habits and tastes of the people who built them were different. As time goes by, men's ideas are always changing. Each of these men knew a different kind of world. In the 15th century, in the 16th and 17th centuries, the 18th century, the 19th century, and the present day. Houses change just as much as clothes. We can follow these changes through the centuries. In the Middle Ages, when the church played a very great part in people's lives, the finest architecture went into religious buildings. Powerful barons and lords of the manor were able to build large stone houses and castles. These were dangerous and warlike times, so that they had to be protected against attack by thick walls, small windows, towers and battlements. This is Stokesay Castle, a good example of a fortified manor house. But most people lived in very simple cottages. Their framework was of timber. Two pairs of split tree trunks were set up like this to support the main roof beam. The spaces between these timbers were filled with woven sticks and plastered with mud. This kind of work is known as wattle and daub. By the 15th and 16th centuries, these methods had been improved. Now the wooden frames for the walls and roof were put together on the ground and then fitted into place. To use a term common today, they were prefabricated. The space between the beams was still often filled with wattle and daub, and window panes were still very small, as ways of making larger sheets of glass were unknown. But houses were becoming far more elaborate. The new class that had displaced the old fighting nobility did not want to fortify their homes. Instead, they built comfortable houses suitable for peaceful conditions. They were often richly ornamented outside, and inside, the walls might be covered with paneling, painting, or tapestries. This new rich class owed much of its wealth to trade, particularly in wool and woolen cloth. Trade caused more people to live in towns. Tall, overhanging houses became more and more closely crowded together along narrow, crooked streets. Now, in the 16th century, at the height of the Tudor period, new ideas and new learning were spreading. This was made easier by the development of printing, which enabled far more people to buy books. Also, explorers were discovering unknown parts of the world and coming home with strange stories. Trade with distant countries increased. Many new ideas were reaching this country from the continent. In Italy, interest in the art and literature of Greece and Rome had produced the wonderful Italian Renaissance of the 15th century and a new architecture which used classical forms. This classical fashion began to be strongly felt in England during Queen Elizabeth's reign. At first it showed only in details, the main part of the building carrying on medieval traditions. This is Hatfield House. It is ornaments such as these pilasters and columns which show the classical influence. Other parts, the windows for instance, still look medieval. But by the 17th and 18th centuries, medieval architecture was over, together with much of medieval thought and ways of life. Here is Rotham House, a building of the full English Renaissance. It is simple, perfectly proportioned, and very lovely. By the 18th century, this classical combination of simplicity and grace of proportion can be seen equally well in much smaller houses. They also show many classical details in their decoration. This Georgian style is in some ways our best domestic architecture. Houses were of brick or timber with overlapping planks, while stone was used in the parts of the country where it is found. Classical forms did not show themselves only in single houses, but also in the planning of towns. The Romans had liked long open thoroughfares and squares in their towns, and now in England, terraces, squares and crescents began to replace the old narrow streets. Each individual house was built as part of a larger design. This crescent at Bath is a good example. Inside these houses, there is the same use of good classical proportions and the same sense of space and order. Furniture, too, was in perfect harmony with the room. Although further great changes were beginning, this tradition lasted well into the 19th century, which saw the height of classical fashions in woman's dress. Houses were now more elegant to match the greater elegance of society. In Cheltenham is a good example of the so-called Regency architecture. The beautiful ironwork of the balconies and other fittings is most characteristic. But it is well to remember that the many servants needed to run such houses had to live in dark basements and to sleep in attics. Now changes which had been preparing for some time began to affect the life of the whole country. The steam engine had been invented. Coal could be used as a source of power. Much more iron was being made. Machines were set to work for men. A class of rich factory owners rose to power, just as the new merchant class had risen in Tudor times. Also, a huge class of factory workers grew. The population increased to four times its former numbers. Everyone had to live somewhere. New towns were rushed up without any plan. Rows and rows of ugly, cheap little houses all jumbled up with factories. Tenements were built and usually became slums. As for the new rich, they'd lost all the 18th century's traditions of good taste. Instead of forming traditions of their own, they tried to imitate the past. They copied medieval Gothic. And even Oriental styles. Inside such houses, it was much the same. They were crammed with pictures and ornaments and too much curly furniture. At the same time, every man built only for himself. Ideas of street planning were forgotten, The new streets were a hodgepodge of badly proportioned houses. In 1914, the First World War put a sudden end to what remained of these Victorian ways of living. It also stopped all house building. At the end of that war, several millions of houses were needed in a hurry. Some local councils carried out large housing schemes. The great job began of clearing the slums left over from the 19th century. It was realized that for a healthy life, all people needed well-planned houses, either a house or a flat of their own. But mostly, new housing wasn't planned at all. Workmanship was poor, the right use of land and the real needs of the home and good design took second place. Any kind of a house was somewhere to live. Towns were growing bigger and uglier all the time. More and more people wanted to get away from them and live where there was fresh air and green grass. Houses were built along the main roads that led out into the country. But instead of the pleasant villages and small towns that could have been made, endless ugly suburbs, neither town nor country, sprawled outwards from the big cities. The speculative builder played on people's love of the past. You've all seen imitation Tudor houses with boards nailed to the walls to look like old beams. In the past, the beams had a job to do. They held up the whole house. Here, they're just nailed on and don't do anything. But the story doesn't end here. Once again, in recent years, things have been happening in the world to change our ways of living and our tastes. Only recently have people started to use materials and methods of construction made possible by modern industry. Instead of fussy and complicated decoration, we have learned once again to prefer the textures and surfaces of building materials themselves, of brick. Of timber. By using big sheets of glass and long steel girders, we can now make rooms that open up and seem almost part of the garden. We have discovered that houses for everybody can be made beautiful and good to live in by using simple shapes and good proportions in every part of them. So once more, it is a question of materials and ways of living coming together to make a new architecture. Just as in the Middle Ages, stone and wattle and daub and timber were made into buildings which were right for the life of that time, so our new materials and methods must be made into houses which are right for our own.